Hi, it's Larry Herb, Xbox's Major Nelson. Welcome to the podcast. Another week, another show, more games, more news, more Jeff.
More me. That sounds like a Mirage line, I think.
That's right. It does. Speaking of Apex.
How about a little more me?
Got a little Apex action going on. We'll talk about that in the show. Got a little interview action that Jeffrey did. Thank you for that.
Oh, yeah. Happy to be here. To talk more of that. Yakuza and Apex. It's my life.
Well, you know, you are a Yakuza influencer.
I'm starting to believe that may be the case because I do, you know, it is certainly not scientific, but the amount of times it gladdens me when I see someone like reply to something and be like, I played Yakuza because of you incessantly talking about it and I love it. And I'm like, yes.
We have somebody that works on our team, Richard, who we were doing a meeting yesterday. And I didn't think he was going to get it. I remember he messaged me a few weeks ago. He's like, I'm playing a lot of this game. And then yesterday he told you to your face, he's like, you're the reason I'm in this. So it was great.
It was Yakuza like a dragon. I'm telling you, you know, it might not be for you, but you don't know if it's for you until you've tried it. And once you try it, you might be all in. Here's the thing. I didn't know. It turned out that it was not for me.
Yeah.
Something. And now it is for me. Something like that.
And now it's for everybody. And it's especially for you if you have Game Pass.
That is true. Oh, yeah, we are coming up. We're just, you know, we've had Yakuza 4, 3, 4, and 5, and then 6 is just a month away. I'm making progress. Actually, that's what I'm playing. I started Yakuza 4. So I finished Yakuza 3. We talked about that last week. And I was like, well, let me give myself a little bit of space before Yakuza 4 for jumping into that. And I ended up playing Haven. I talked a little bit about this game last week. It's made,
What is the game for those people that didn't hear last week or they're not familiar?
Yes. So it's made by a French team, Game Bakers, and it's sort of a very colorful, exploratory RPG. There's definitely RPG and battle elements, like turn-based RPG elements, but it is not quite like that. It really focuses on like a relationship between these two characters, and like if you've played Persona or something like that, that's the beginnings of a relationship. You're flirting with people. I do. And then like it peaks at like, you know, like, oh, you have a real social link with them. This is later. Like this is a couple that's been together and what their dynamic is like. And they're still discovering things about each other, but they're all in on each other. And you don't see that represented in games. You see that in movies all the time. Well, this felt like a movie level sort of like dialogue and experience. And basically every time like you make dinner together, you know, because you cook, you go out, you find different things that you can, you know, for sustenance, and you blend them together. And there ends up being like a cutscene, or every time you go to sleep, there's, you know, one person can't sleep and you end up having dialogue. And that's how you level up. You increase your chemistry together. And then that gives you more hit points. It improves your powers, your blast attacks, your impact attacks, or how you attack together. And it was like, and it was a joy. It's just so different taking the sort of like numerical aspect into it. There's still numbers, but it's not, it's just a very different take. Anyway, it's on Xbox Game Pass. By the way, the soundtrack is absolutely phenomenal. I added it on Spotify. It's by a band called Danger, a French techno band. And there is just a lot to like here. I would say load it up. Let it play, by the way, the attract mode, if you will, like sort of the animation that plays at the beginning. And in fact, I want you to do this, Larry. Okay. Very reminiscent of like a watercolor sketch of like Take On Me.
You know, I love that, you know, video.
Which I know you love that. In fact, I want you to start downloading it during one of the interviews. And then it's only a short game. It's like 4 gigs or something. It doesn't take up a lot of space. And then the music, if that doesn't grab you, then maybe this game's not going to be for you. And I would also say your music taste needs some work if it does not grab you. So anyway, Haven, really loved it. Check it out. Great voice acting. Looks beautiful. Really interesting game. It's about I think it took me 17 hours to beat. So it's not a huge commitment. Then I jump back into Yakuza 4, which actually starts in a very different way. And so I'm super into that too. So man, I'm just happy about things right now. I'm happy about gaming.
You're happy about gaming.
Let's narrow it down here. There's many things to enjoy. on the gaming side. What about you, Larry? What do you play? Sea of Thieves back there.
I've got Joe Neate, the executive producer for Sea of Thieves. I've got him on the show. We'll do a good interview, long interview later on. He and I talk about that, and hopefully he'll take my feature request. I'm playing Little Nightmares 2. You can see that right about here.
Yeah.
And then over, terrible, it's blurry, but we've got Apex over here. I'm still chugging away through the medium. I've got Carto over here. So this is the show right here, right? It's just,
yeah.
Those are the active things that I'm kind of been working against. It's funny because I'm over here with my console trying to find Haven. So that's what I've been clicking through over here. So bear with me a moment.
Well, how are you enjoying Little Nightmares 2? So like this week, and I think we might've talked about it last week, we've invited a number of Black creators to join Xbox or Twitch's Xbox channel, Xbox's Twitch channel. And in that first one, we had Zombie Kills. She came on and she streamed Little Nightmares 2. And man, it was a very stressful stream. It's funny because it looks like it has like very, I don't want to say cute, but it doesn't look like your typical horror game. But it can be super scary even when it's not, you know, blood gushing or anything. It can be disturbing.
Horror. It's suspense. There's a lot going on in this game, and it is a little concerning. By the way, I just want to point out that there you go, 3.71. I'm down.
All right, good. All right, you're downloading. Awesome. Using the light mode.
I'm using the automatic mode.
Oh, so in the day it's
at night, it's dark.
Maybe I should do that.
You do what you want to do. Do what you want to do.
Player choice.
It's all about choice.
It's our mantra.
So I'm Little Nightmares 2. I think I'm at the second chapter. I don't really want to say too much for spoilers reason, but yeah, I mean there's some stressful moments in there, and there's some disturbing things that happen, and it's Little Nightmares. Hmm. It's just like you'd expect.
Okay. Still nightmare. Emphasis on the nightmares.
On the nightmares. Do you have nightmare? Do you have dream? Do you dream at all when you're sleeping?
I have very lucid dreams. Yes. Really? I usually remember them, for quite a while. And remember we were talking like a few months ago after I was playing all those Ubisoft games, like, Assassin's Creed and Watch Dogs and Phoenix Rising. I ended up dreaming. I had a recurring dream. I was working at Ubisoft. And so, yeah, I tend to have, in fact, Haven very much insinuated itself in my dreams, especially the music. And I was dreaming about the music a lot, and it was really interesting. So, yeah, sometimes you're in my dreams. Yeah.
Really?
God, yeah.
I hope I'm not some weird character.
In a professional capacity, Larry. Okay, we're coworkers. We talk all the time. Yeah. Most of my dreams are work related, which is interesting, and usually take place in either Philly, where I'm from, or London for some reason. A lot of dreams in London.
That's interesting. I wish I could say that, but I may dream, but when I wake up, I'm just like, I don't remember anything. Very rarely do I dream, but what does happen is sometimes later that day or that the next later day, I'm like, oh, wait a minute. I had this crazy dream, you know? And so it's downloaded.
There it is. So here, go ahead and hit it. And there's like a really cool sort of art style that will kick in when it goes to the attract mode. You'll see it'll go white and there'll be some dots that are going there. As you can see, it's a very colorful game just based on that key art, if you will. And those, the two characters there are U and K, Y-U and K-A-Y. Actually, now that I'm thinking about it, they escape. They leave the place that they're from. I wonder if it's like a... if it's referencing Brexit in some way. I don't know. We'll have to ask the developers.
And where is this? Oh, it's made in, where is it made?
It's in Piran. I think it's France. Just let it go.
Oh, you're right. This is just I haven't even pressed A yet.
Yeah, this is just like once I saw this, I was like, I'm going to love this game. This could be off of Daft Punk Discovery, as can a number of other tracks like throughout the...
I'm just going to let it go.
I was just, there's a whole playlist on Spotify by Danger, and they did great work.
Should we let it go?
It's like 3 minutes, so if you want to put it, leave the music under as a bed is what you should do. We can come back. I ended up tweeting at one of the voice actors, because the voice performances are phenomenal as well. See, this game's for you. You're in or you're out at that point.
Yeah.
I when I was starting it off, I was like, Larry's going to like that. He's going to think of Aha, Take on Me, not from the music perspective, but just the style.
The art style is this beautiful very bright watercolors. And there's passion in here.
It's on Xbox Game Pass for PC and for console.
But what kind of
you can actually pass back and forth.
Is it an RPG?
So you explore. It's not. You control your characters. It's very exploratory. It gets into story, so I wouldn't just start it. You don't just jump right in and start playing. Right. But really cool opening, right? And so you've got like these rocket boots, and the two of you are always together, but you can choose who takes the lead, and you're sort of like, okay, so you like this is what the game looks like, and you're sort of skating or rocketing through the grass, and you're like exploring and you're searching and you're like sort of almost in a Super Mario Sunshine-esque way cleaning up like this rust, this sort of like this mess that's on the planet. You end up uncovering everything about it, and all the questions are answered. There's some great world building it took me about 16 hours, and I played really thoroughly. And so you could definitely clear through it quicker than that.
The recent Seattle snowpocalypse, didn't you?
I did. I finished it while it was snowing out. We got how much snow did you get up by your way? It's all melted now.
We probably got about at least 12 or 13 inches when all was said and done.
It's interesting because it's one of those things where, and we're seeing this now, and I hope if you're watching this in the middle of the country in Texas or someplace that you're doing well.
And you're warm.
But it's sort of like this thing where if you're in the Midwest, you're like, oh, foot of snow, who cares? But you know, if you're not used to having it, if your city's not equipped for it, and by the way, we have hills, okay, like very steep. It's like San Francisco level here. You can't drive on that.
No.
And if you're not used to this type of, you know, the infrastructure is not there, then it can be really tough. So as soon as it starts snowing, it was like, that's it. We're not leaving the house. We're not going anywhere as long as you can't walk there. It's really good. And some of the music within the game is even better.
Haven. Anyway.
Xbox Game Pass. So, you know what's...
We're 20 minutes and we're completely off the rails.
I know. So do you want to keep doing, there's a couple of news pieces that are worth, this was a pretty momentous week. So we had a headset. So the only thing I can think of that's better than like being able to play the games that you bought years ago to be able to just re-download them into your Xbox Series S or Series X. Only thing that could be better would be if they're better too. And we made an announcement this week that is beginning to happen. So, we announced something called FPS Boost. And what that means is that there are certain games that are the wizards at our backward compatibility team are making certain games that had some overhead because they're playing now on a much more powerful system than they were conceived to be able to run at double or even quadruple the frame rate. So we're talking games like Far Cry 4, Sniper Elite 4, Watch Dogs 2, UFC 4, moving from 30 to 60 frames a second. What's so funny, Larry?
Just keep going because I have an interview for this. I forgot to tell you it's somebody who obviously wants your job.
Is it Jason Ronald's back? Well, then I'm just going to shut up. Why don't we just go to Jason? That's 2 weeks in a row. He's moving in.
He's moving in.
He's making himself comfortable.
All right.
He's going
to... Let's talk to Jason about the frame rate boost and then we'll come back and we'll do more news.
Maybe I'll be here. Maybe I will.
2 weeks in a row. I guess, Jason, you're really gunning for Jeff's position right now, but you're back because you got some interesting news. We had you on last week to talk about dashboard updates from engineering, but this week you got something really, really cool. Tell us about it.
Yeah, we're excited to share. Earlier this week, we released the first set of what we call FPS boosted titles. Back in December, we showed a prototype of some of the work that we were doing via the backcompat program to actually double the frame rate of existing games with no work by game developers.
Right.
And this week, we're sharing the first set of titles that actually take full advantage of that. And in these cases, the titles were historically running at 30 frames a second, and now we're able to get them to run at 60 frames a second. And there's even titles that were able to go from 60 frames a second all the way to 120 frames a second. And it's really delivering on that next-gen promise and that commitment to, you know, the real feel and fidelity of the games that you play on the Xbox platform.
So this is amazing. So it's FPS Boost is kind of coming to some of our back compat titles. And what developers need to do is nothing, right? Because it's all being handled at the platform level, right, Jason?
Yeah, we handle this at the platform layer. And with all this extra power that we have with the Xbox Series X and Series S, what used to take 33 milliseconds for a game to actually process, we can do in half or a quarter of the time. So with all that extra processing power, we can really make sure that we're able to run the game at higher frame rates. And the only thing that a game developer needs to do is we partner with them and we make sure that they're still really happy with the experience. But there's no engineering work they need to do. There's no configuration work they need to do. We handle it all at the platform layer.
Yeah, I got to tell you, I downloaded, I don't know if you can see it here, but I have Far Cry 4, which Jeff and I played through, did co-op, I think, the entire game. And it was a ton of fun. And that's one of the ones that is getting FPS boost from 30 to near 60. And it is, I mean, it's smooth. It's butter. I haven't checked out Super Lucky's Tale. I know I've got a 120 hertz TV behind me, so I'm going to have to check that out too. Some of these are really game changing, aren't they?
Absolutely. You know, and you see this even today with games that have been optimized for the developer, where players are really saying frame rate matters. And it's so great to be able to go back into the back catalog and identify games that can take advantage of this new capability that we have. And then from a player's perspective, we're in a future update, we're actually going to provide the option to enable a player to enable or disable this on the titles that we've enabled it for. So that way, if you want to play it the way that the game was originally running on, say, an Xbox 360 or an Xbox One, you can do so. But if you want that best in class experience and you want to run at the faster frame rates, you can enable that as well and just get that full fidelity experience.
And what's great is if you're an Xbox Game Pass subscriber, then, you know, some of these titles that we just mentioned here are actually in Game Pass. So you can actually download them and you're getting it for free part of your subscription anyway, but you can check them out. There's no barrier to entry. So that's pretty extraordinary as well.
Exactly. You know, and one of the things that we learned from the auto HDR work that we did last fall is players actually want to know when their game's actually being enhanced by the platform.
Right.
So just like we added the capability when you pull up the guide to see whether or not auto HDR is enabled, in an update coming in the next couple months, you'll also be able to see whether or not the game's being boosted with its frame rate so that you know that you are getting that premium experience.
Yeah, and what Jason's talking about is if you've played on Xbox Series or X or S and you see Quick Resume, you usually see that in the upper corner right over here somewhere. I'm trying to show you. it'll pop up for just a second to show you. So what your team is going to do is add even more there to really tell people, hey, you're having an amazing experience, right?
Yep, exactly. And, you know, and I think it's important because, you know, for many of these games, we remember how they play and we have these fond memories. But, you know, if you haven't played the game in a while, you might forget that the game was originally running at 30 frames a second. So we want to make sure that you know that you're really getting this boosted FPS experience through the power of the platform and through the power of what we can deliver with the Xbox Series X and S.
Yeah, and to your point, Jason, back way back when, I mean, maybe you didn't have a TV that could do 60 hertz or 60 frames per second or even 120 frames per second. Those are brand new. Mm-hmm. So now you can kind of go, you know, with your television, your display option, and your Xbox Series X or S, it kind of unlocks these new options. Can we expect more titles, or what's kind of the roadmap ahead for some of these FPS boost titles?
Yeah, this week is just the first set of titles that we're releasing. We have many more titles that are in development and in testing right now, and we'll continue to release more titles over the coming months. Unfortunately, this technique does not work on all titles. You know, in some cases, the way that the game was originally written, you know, as we've been doing some testing of some of these titles, we've seen like animations run twice as fast or like physics running twice as fast. Yeah. And what's critically important to us is that we always respect the original intent of the creator. So that's why we're able to do this at the platform level. And then we work with the developer and the publisher and make sure that they still believe this really aligns with what they originally intended. And then we'll enable them for players, like you said, whether the game's in Game Pass or maybe it's a game that you have on physical media, like, we really want to make sure that we're just giving you that best in class experience.
You know, I was thinking about this because with our back compat program, and now we've got, you know, with the auto HDR you talked about earlier that we implement, and now FPS Boost, it's almost like that Xbox Series X and S is almost like it's the best place to play some of these classic games. You know, we're preserving these memories for you and, you know, your family and your son or your daughter, or whoever, to really get them into gaming in the best possible way. So I just, again, hats off to that back compat team. They're just, we've always called them magicians, and they seem to be redefining their magic again and again. So, Jason, thanks so much. Just a quick reminder, Dragon Age Inquisition, Watch Dogs 2, Sniper Elite 4, UFC 4, Far Cry 4, Super Lucky's Tale running at 120 hertz. All the rest of those are running up to 60, so it's really, or near 60. It's pretty amazing. So thanks for that. I'll link off to the blog post, and again, we'll get you on when we have some more news, Jason. Anything else to add before I let you go?
Just, we're really excited, and I could totally agree with you. Like, the back compat team continues to do amazing work, and we're really excited for what we're going to deliver later this year.
Thanks, Jason.
The real JR, Jason Ronald, thanks so much for once again co-hosting the show.
2 weeks in a row. And, come on.
Look, here's the thing. I show up, and I talk about a song I like. He shows up, and he's like, look what my team did. They made a bunch of games better. So he deserves the spot. I'm just going to relinquish it, but always great to hear from JR. And he actually had a really great interview talking about how this was done with Colt Eastwood. So if you're, you know,
I love that. I love him. I need to.
Yeah. He's a great guy. You know, someone we've talked to for a long time, and he had some really great questions. And so it was a really enlightening interview. You can find that over on YouTube, to shirts for Colt Eastwood. And you know, he's got a very good audio setup, very sort of jealous. He's got like a full studio. He's a guitarist. I think he plays his theme song. He is. Yeah. Anyway, so a little bit more news here before we get into some of our other interviews. Thank you. Every other show. What do we talk about? Every other show.
Yakuza.
The gift that keeps on giving. Well, yeah, we talk about Yakuza every show. Yeah. Xbox Game Pass, more games announced this week. I'm really excited about this. If you hadn't played Dirt 5, one of the showcases, yes, I think, for technology on Xbox Series S and Series X, great team, Cody's, that pulled that together. So,
That's industry slang for Codemasters,
Cody's. And so that is coming on February 25th on cloud, console, and PC.
Should we get David? Maybe we'll get
really
David
enjoyed
on
this game.
David Springgate. So he's a good.
That would be great. Yeah. No, I talked to him on Twitter, and he's it's a really fun game. They've added a lot of features. They've added. They've continued to iterate onto the game with new content, and it's just really fun. I had a lot of fun with it, a lot of cool modes, and of course it's beautiful. What else? We've got Elite Dangerous on console. It's like, what if you put the whole galaxy in a game? Yes. You know, like, literally, like, you can fly it up Alpha Centauri, you can just, like, it's almost took, like,
I think I played it for an hour and couldn't even undock my spaceship because it's like crazy. So
yeah, they've added a lot more to it in terms of, like, space combat. I think you might even be able to get out of the ship these days. This is a game that they've been iterating on for a long time. Yeah, I want to say I played it at PAX East 2015 for the first time, and here we are in 2021. Definitely, if you know, a real life, you know, mapping of the galaxy and go wherever you want sounds like something that's fun to you, you should definitely give it a shot. And you can play this in the background just for that suitable space vibes.
I need that link.
You're going to be playing this forever.
Playlist, by the way.
I will send that to you as soon as we're off here. A couple more games. Killer Queen Black. If you've been into an arcade at any point in the last couple of years, you've probably seen Killer Queen. It's like sort of a new school arcade game that is made, I want to say, up at this part of the country.
You're right.
Very much elements of like Joust and like four people playing at once. Well, now it's coming to Xbox, and it's coming straight into Xbox Game Pass, which is phenomenal, on February 23rd. And you can play solo, but you'll want to team up with three friends. And there's up to three possible victory conditions, which is really cool.
Killer Queen Black.
We also have, Pillars of Eternity 2 Deadfire, which is the ultimate edition from our good friends at Obsidian Entertainment, a mega huge RPG of a very different style than a game like Haven. And this is the sort of the ultimate version of that. We've got Wreckfest coming to console, PC, and cloud. And then a couple of games that I believe are on the console, but now coming to Game Pass for PC. Super Hot Mind Control Delete. You might have played Super Hot years ago when it first came out. Mind Control Delete, the edition, essentially double the size of the game. And then Code Vein, which is a really cool looking game from Bandai Namco, with I heard one of the best character creators in games of the past few years.
That's
all those. Coming soon.
It's good to know.
To Xbox Game Pass.
Xbox Game Pass.
You good?
Yeah,
I'm good. Yeah. So who are we talking to next here, Larry?
Well, you've got a couple people. We're going to talk about Apex. You were able to do the Apex interview. We've got, so why don't we do that, Jeff? Why don't we go ahead and we'll talk to Chad from the Apex
team. Chad Grenier?
Yep, yeah. We'll talk to him from the Apex team. And then after that, on the other side of it, we are going to talk. I'm really excited to talk to Joe Neate, who's the executive producer for Sea of Thieves. So Jeff is going to take it away. We're going to talk first, Apex.
If we were to rename the Xbox podcast based on what we talk about on the show, there's a good chance this would be called the Apex Legends Weekly Podcast. And so it is well, well overdue that we bring someone on from Respawn Entertainment. And we did not just bring in anyone on. We're bringing on Chad Grenier, the game director of Apex Legends at Respawn Entertainment. Chad, thank you so much for joining us.
You're welcome. I'm happy to be here. Thanks, Jeff.
This is how we've been able to connect throughout the entirety of where we've been indoors for the last year. I got to say, you've got some big fans here. We're 2 years in. I've put in over 500 hours. Still no heirloom. We'll talk about that off camera. But, this is a game that we've just had so much fun with. And over the course of the last 2 years, you're celebrating the 2-year anniversary of Apex. Can you just talk a little bit about what these last couple of years have been like and the journey that the game has been on? Because it's changed tremendously since its launch back in 2019.
Yeah, it has. The history of Respawn, we had released, we hadn't done live service game before. And so we were creating this multiplayer game that we thought, would be pretty good. We were playing it every night at the studio, closer to launch, we were playing it like all hours of the night. We wouldn't go home from work. We just were playing this game. And so we hoped that other people would enjoy it. And, but you never really know. So we released this game in secrecy and, just kind of surprise launched it thinking, hey, maybe we'll get, a million players over a couple years or, maybe a year, we'll have a million players and we'll grow this thing slow over time. Well, we hit a million players like in the first day and had a bit of a sinking feeling like, uh-oh, what do we do? Like now what? And, so we played a bit of catch up trying to build the live service muscles and figure out, okay, now how do we go from working on a project for 3 years to like releasing every month? We've learned how to do that over the last 2 years. And of course we've grown to, I think the last number we've announced was 50 million, but we're far beyond that at this point. So it's been a bit of a roller coaster ride. It's been, the game has been far more successful than I think any of us could have predicted, which is a good problem to have, but also caught us a bit off guard. And we finally hit our stride, I feel like, in the last year, and we've streamlined like development. We're releasing, I think, really good content at a regular basis. And we've got so many awesome things that are coming up that I can't even talk about that the team is just like pumped about right now.
So throughout its history, Apex has been really a pioneer in the battle royale sphere, introducing things like nonverbal communication, which makes it like almost a pleasure sometimes to play with people you're not even speaking with. Also really great. I have a kid who I won't allow her to speak to other strangers online, but she can communicate, she can ping things and all of the different conversation that the different legends have make it really easy to play as a team. Also things like rezzing. There's just so many things that Apex pioneered that in many ways have become industry standard within this genre. So what is the team focused on now?
Well, the team is always trying to find little innovations, big or small. We're all gamers, and so we play the game a lot. We play a lot of other games. We're fairly good at identifying what the game needs or things that work or don't work in other games, and trying to make our game as good as it can be. And so when you're talking about the ping system and the respawning, that just comes from the team playing the game every single night and just ideas coming from anyone on the team, whether it's an artist or an animator or designer. It could be the janitor for all we care. A good idea is a good idea. We don't care where it comes from. And so that's how those things, you know, foster themselves. So now the team is pretty focused on coming up with how to expand Apex as a brand and how to offer more to more people. You know, you mentioned that we're a big player in the VR space, and that's great, but I think we have bigger aspirations. And so I'm always asking and challenging the team to expand a bit beyond Battle Royale. Not, you know, it doesn't mean we're going to stop support for Battle Royale. It's still what the game is made of, and that's our core. But, you know, what else are we offering? I think we've got these great legends that people love, and they've got, you know, interesting gameplay abilities. We've got interesting universe and maps, and the gunplay is really good. So why not offer something else? And you see that happening with some of our limited time modes. But, you know, I think we're thinking bigger than limited time, and we've certainly been playtesting a lot of really fun things that we're going to bring to the game soon.
All right. Thanks, Chad. So when you're evolving the game, as it has evolved significantly with new maps and new evolutions to the map, really like where you're at with King's Canyon right now, how do you balance sentimentality, what gamers might say they might want? I mean, you took away Skulltown, but I feel like it made the game better. So how do you balance what's good for the game versus what people might say they want or what they might think they want?
Yeah, it's always really hard. The Skulltown decision that you mentioned, it was a tough call. You know, our opinion is that if you're building a live service game, you need to be changing things up. You need to take players on some sort of a journey. You can't be stale. And so Skulltown being like the most popular drop spot was the biggest way we could shake things up, but also the most risky because players love Skulltown. But, you know, at the end of the day, we wanted to switch, you know, change things up and introduce a big change to the map. And so Skulltown was, of course, like the first thing with the target on its back. So, you know, we just do it. We can always bring things back, right? It's a live service game. No change is permanent. You know, we've reverted things in the past, you know, balance changes, we've pulled back and whatnot. So I think I encourage the team to just be gutsy and go big, do big things, and take players on a journey. It also opens up opportunities to bring Skulltown back in one way or another. You know, there might be a return of Skulltown at some point. Can't confirm or deny.
So you've continued really shaking up the game with a number of limited time modes. I'm really enjoying Armed and Dangerous Night right now. I love that I land and there's just like a lot of cool stuff. Always was a big fan of Always Be Closing has been one that we've seen come through a few times. My daughter's gotten very into, you know, the Christmas train mode. But when you're looking at what to do and what these different options are, like how does that work come through? Is there like a whiteboard of like just crazy ideas and then eventually some of them come to fruition?
Kind of. Yeah. Game modes are one of the things that are like a treat for the design team. It's like everybody wants to make a mode. Everyone's got an idea for a mode. And it's like after somebody, maybe they complete like a larger feature, like I'm going to make a mode. It's like, okay, you know, so-and-so is on the next mode. And there's just a million ideas for modes. And I think they're good for the game because they switch things up and they give you like a different way to play every now and then. You know, if you're playing the game every day, it's like a nice little side treat. And in some cases, they don't serve a purpose other than somebody on the team wants to try it and they think it'd be cool. And we put it in there. In other cases, we can test changes to the game ahead of time. Like if we want to know what it would be like if you spawned with a Mozambique, we can test that in an LTM and maybe roll that into the game. We saw that with Evo armor. We did an LTM where everyone started with white level Evo armor. And that actually made us get to the point where we realized all the armor should be Evo armor. And that was because of some, you know, playtesting the LTM. And so they kind of serve multiple purposes, but they're just fun to create. We've got some crazy ones coming too.
You laughed. I laughed only because I couldn't hear you after about 15 seconds again.
And I didn't touch anything. So we're not, Jeff, we're not going to do this right now because I don't want to, I don't know what's going on here. And I feel like I'm wasting Chad's time and your time. So we're going
to, if you think we're going to be able to pull this together, I only had one more question. So,
you know,
let's see what we can salvage. I feel like, you know, and I'm very interested in watching this myself. So it'll be a
If you guys need me, if you want to do the question, that's fine. And if you need me back, I mean, I can make time. It's not a big deal.
Okay.
I appreciate that. Why don't we just
do the final question?
Yeah. Okay. Right.
Go ahead and do the final question, and you guys can hear each other for now. So here we go.
All right. This is a game, like I said, we've put in hundreds of hours, and so we've got a shorthand for everything. The triple take is the TT, and the flat line is the flatty, but can you help us sort out one issue that we're constantly coming up? Is Gibraltar Jibby or Gibby? What do you call him?
Yeah, potato, potato a little bit. We call him Gibby internally a lot.
I lost the bet. I know. In this house, he is Jibby. The characters have been awesome and have really just enjoyed as you continue to bring folks in and a diversity of different characters. And I think that's been really awesome. Actually, before I let you go, I'm just curious just how you think about it. You know, when it comes to bringing in new legends, you've even fooled us a couple of times, which I thought was just really interesting as people thought they knew what was coming. And then that character was completely faked, and then we got Revenant, I think it was for that time. So do you mind, just before I let you go, I'd just love to know how again you're looking at characters, and again to just commend you on the diversity of characters that we see.
Yeah, thanks. We legends always start with gameplay, and so they have gameplay hooked. You know, what kind of abilities are missing from the game? What sort of play styles are we not representing? And we always start from there. The personalities and the way the legends look usually come secondary. And the diversity, it's something we're all really proud of. Our team is very diverse. We've got, you know, all walks of life on our team, and that really helps. Wouldn't say make it easy, but it just, you know, when ideas are coming from everyone on the team, everything's going to be represented, whether it's, you know, a nationality or a sexuality or, you know, whatever it may be. We're just well represented at the studio, which is something we've intentionally hired for. And it's important to Respawn. So
the voice actors are phenomenal as well. So great work there. And it's really something you noticed, I think, on Dummy's Big Day when everyone was quiet, how much of the game, which was a limited time mode and no one was talking, you realized how much just their conversational chatter adds to just the atmosphere as you're playing.
Yeah, the voice actors are great. You know, there's the casting has been phenomenal. You know, huge props to our audio team, and especially during COVID and working from home, they've managed to do all of these studio recordings for the voice actors without going into a studio. So they're doing the recordings much like this on a call with the actor with his microphone in their home and getting voice direction over a video call like this. And so it's pretty phenomenal. So kudos to them. And the amount of work the voice actors have is insane. Every time we add a new legend or a new weapon, there's like something like 10 or 15,000 new voice lines that have to be recorded per legend, right? You add a new weapon, like you add the, you know, the 30-30 repeater. And then you have to get every single voice actor back in the studio to say 30-30 repeater here and little things like that for all the pings and whatnot. And so it's like there's a whole group of people just doing the VO recording. It's crazy.
All right, Chad, thank you so much. I am curious. I've been a Lifeline main since day one. So every time you bring someone in else new, I give them a shot. Still end up back with Lifeline. She's just such a great team player. I will stick with her. Although Loba, I appreciate what you've done with her because she's my number two. Helps alleviate some fights here in our house. So thank you so much. I'm hoping that we can talk to you again in another 2 years when we're celebrating, you know, many more millions of people have played and new who knows, new maps, new legends, new game modes and everything else. But, I want to thank you again for helping Larry and I and our families and everyone to sort of, stay together and keep communicating throughout throughout our time here in lockdown. And we're wishing our best to your team as well, who are doing amazing work, in what I'm sure are very trying circumstances.
Yeah, thank you. Appreciate it. Love the support from you guys. So thank you.
I'm very excited to have us joining me on the show today is Mr. Joe Neate. Joe is the executive producer for Sea of Thieves, a game that I've been playing a lot lately. Joe, thank you for joining us.
It's a pleasure to be here.
Great to see you again. I got to tell you, you and I haven't seen each other in quite a while, but first of all, congratulations. It's a third year anniversary for Sea of Thieves. That is amazing. Tell us a little bit about that journey, because it feels like just yesterday you launched.
I know, right? It's been an amazing almost 3 years now, and kind of even taking in, I guess, the process before that with our insiders and the beta and everything. It's like we feel like we've been delivering and building on this for a really long time now, but it's also flown by as a team, and it's been amazing. Sea of Thieves has grown each year. We're in the kind of biggest place we've ever been as a game. And it's just been amazing journey as a team, especially for us as a studio. It's the first time we've done a game like this, it's been amazing.
And it's interesting because, and I think you and I have told this story, I believe, together before, but it's worth telling one more time. I remember many years ago when you and your team came over to Redmond. You guys are based over there in England. You came over to Redmond and were pitching the game. It wasn't even a game slice, as they call it in the industry. But I remember it was a conference room on the third floor of the Studio D. I remember this. It was like it was yesterday. And you had a bunch of PCs around the conference room, and we came and we played a very, very, very early version of the game. I mean, it's nothing like you see today. And I remember, I remember you gave me a pirate name, and we all had pirate names, which I still have in my office. And it was just a great, because it was like, I was like, oh, this is great. You could see it, the teamwork, and to see that, which was essentially like stick figures, to come into this amazingly beautiful game, Sea of Thieves. Tell us a little bit about that journey, because that's amazing.
Yeah, so part of working in an organization like Xbox, right, is informing and exciting everybody within the organization, right? And that's a big part of kind of what you need to do when you're building something, especially when you're building something new. And so actually we kind of came up with this idea of, let's just go across to Redmond, let's book out that meeting room, which to book out a full meeting room for an entire week takes some doing, right? In Redmond, like, we had to get executive kind of support on that from, I think kind of Phil Spencer's executive assistant at the time. But we hired some PCs from a local kind of place. Dave Quinn, our team member in Redmond, helped us with that. We went to a pirate fancy dress shop and kind of bought a load of pirate clothes and gear and a little Polaroid camera as well. And the kind of printer as well for the names and everything. So we had the whole gear and kind of took everybody through that play test and the kind of original pitch at the same time, right? So you got to see the vision, do the play test, and then actually see our kind of beautiful kind of corner island that we'd built in Unreal. So we were like, hey, look, it plays like this and it's going to look like that, right?
Right, right.
We just took kind of people from across the organization through that during a week to really just get people on board with, hey, Rare's doing something new, they're doing something different, and kind of start building that buzz. And I loved that everybody put the pirate gear on and took a photo, and then we stuck that on their pirate names. But even when we'd gone back to Rare, everybody in kind of Redmond who'd gone through that, probably about 50 people, I guess, during that real exclusive kind of 50 people that you were part of, everyone had a pirate name, right? And so if you went into someone's office and saw the pirate name, you're like, oh, you've played Athena, as it was known then, right? Athena, you were like, oh, you played that, yeah. And everyone could share stories and things. So you had this little kind of club, but it kind of built that excitement and buzz even when we weren't there. It was a really cool kind of process, really kind of unique, but worked really well.
Yeah, and it was great because, you worked on that, and then you went away for a few years, and then launched properly in 2018. And I remember coming out to your studios and meeting you and many of the team who I've met before, but being in your studio, by the way, and I've said this to you, and I've said it to Craig, the head of Rare. Your studio is the single most beautiful studio I've been into anywhere in the world. And I've been to a lot of game studios. Yours is absolutely my favorite, out there in the countryside. And to be able to sit with you all and talk to you about the game, this was right before launch. And I remember we were recording some stuff for Inside Xbox, and it was just, it was a magical place to be. And then the accident that happened, I don't know if you remember this accident, is I walked down the hall to talk to Robin Beanland, who does the audio. And I grabbed the cameras. I said, we have to do something. And we recorded this piece with him where he showed off the instruments, the actual hurdy-gurdy that was recorded for the in-game. And it was just the most amazing experience to see. And every time I play the game now, I'm just in love with the music, the audio, and of course the gameplay. So it just everything kind of snapped together. That's got to be a great feeling to see that.
It is, and it's down to the talent at the studio, right? Like, we have people like Robin's been there 30 years or close to, right? And throughout its kind of journey, you should see some of the photos of him back in the day with the long hair, amazing. But and then you've got people that have joined more recently, and it's that real mix of people. But everyone kind of, the culture of Rare is what makes it special, and the people that you bring into that are the right people, the right fit. They kind of, you know, really, really kind of strengthen the culture of creativity and of risk taking, but they also have incredible talent. So Robin is obviously incredibly talented. He's a magician, right? And he won an Ivor Novello for the Sea of Thieves music, which is a really prestigious award. Oh. Yeah. He won that a couple of years ago. We got to go with him and see him win it. We didn't know if he was going to. It was mind-blowing to see him up on stage being presented by Ricky Wilson from the Kaiser Chiefs, the kind of lead singer of that. He presented it to Robin, which was great. But then we've got so Chloe, who is kind of one of our newer members of the music and audio team, is an incredible talent too. And she's still an intern or not? I'm not sure, but she's right at the start of her career, but she has brought incredible talent into that mix. And that's just the kind of story of Rare, I think, is like there's people like Robin that are incredible. And then people like Chloe who come in and wow us with their singing talent or the different kind of musical instruments they can use, and that they, you know, they bring that kind of special something to the studio, and that's just what makes, I think, Rare so special, and then what makes the games they make so special.
Well, so let's talk about this. You've been on this journey with Sea of Thieves. It is a vastly different game than when you first launched. I mean, the features you've put in, the story, you know, I remember that when in March 2018, people were like, this is, you know, first of all, you know, and correct me if I'm wrong, I remember, I think it was you or Craig told me, you have quite a few artists who just do water, right?
We like the kind of the tech art team, the rendering team, everybody that like were focused on that for so long, VFX in terms of all that spray and the glints and stuff, and it was a real journey to get that right. Like, I remember going through the reviews, and we had the movement kind of feeling good early, but it was for me the moment anyway where it was where it really just suddenly sang almost, was those little glints that you get that just kind of, when the water undulates, you see these little glints flicker on them, and it just, that's almost what makes water look real to me. And it's like, once you just add that almost little kind of reflection and glints on it, and then you start to see the VFX spray and the spray when you cut through it with the boat and things. So, but it's all these layers. And having to make it work across the network so that it plays kind of predictably and things, so all the different boats that are interacting with it get hit by it and kind of moved around. Like, it's an incredible undertaking, but we were like, that's going to be what you're doing most of the time, right? You're going to be out there looking at the sea. You're going to be on the sea. It has to feel right. It has to look right. It has to sound right.
It does all those things. And it feels, I mean, sometimes you just stand on the bow of your ship or in the crow's nest or on the back, and you're staring at the sunset or the sunrise or the moon. And it's simply breathtaking. And one thing I've noticed is, you know, certainly we've got the player characters and some of the NPCs you have in the game, but I would argue that the sea is an incredibly important, and I don't know another word for it, but it's an incredibly important character to the game because it has so much character. It changes the dynamics. Oh, the wind is in our face now, or oh, okay, now we can't see. Is there a ship over there? I can't tell because things are up too high. So it's an incredibly important part of the game.
It is, and it's interesting because of how vast it is, and how it is that big part of the character of the game. It actually, for some people that have a fear of the open water, it can almost act as a bit of a barrier to coming in and playing because of that fear of jumping in and not knowing what's under it, right? There's a phobia, thessalobia or something. I'll pronounce it incorrectly. But and we we put in a kind of single stick control and something that actually helped you float back to the surface as an accessibility option. And we found that actually that as a byproduct helped people who had a phobia because it would kind of stop them with the fear of dropping into the water and not being able to get back and stuff. So like, again, incredible journey to go on to even just find that out, to find out about that kind of fear and to find out that we can do something to help people with that in our game. But almost that a game can have that impact on you, right?
I remember the first time I was playing it. And I, you know, one of the first times I was playing it, maybe it was the first year, I think when you added a few things, we went back in and I was playing with a friend of mine who I won't give his name, Brian Gerard at 343. And he wouldn't go into the water because of the sharks. He's like, I'm not going in the water. Yeah. I'm like, oh, no, just jump. It'll be fine. He would not go into the water, to your point. You know, as when you guys launched in 2018, as I said earlier, it's a very different game than it is now. Tell us a little bit about that journey of the features and the listening to the community. You have this amazing Sea of Thieves insider collection of community. And I mean, the community has just exploded over the years. Tell us a little bit about that journey.
Yeah. Well, so to begin with, prior to launch, we built that insider program. We had a kind of a new community that we wanted to build around this new game, this new IP, right? And so we started, I think it was December 2016 was our first ever insider test with 1,000 people that were invited. And we built up over the kind of next year and through to the actual launch in 2018, where we had about 400,000 insiders, I think. So we'd kind of built this sizable community just by releasing videos and talking and kind of building up a kind of interest, but then going and testing and playtesting with them. And it led us to that launch moment, right? And the launch moment was almost overwhelming, right? Like it was the closed beta was when we first lifted the NDA and allowed anybody to play and stream and create kind of videos and everything. Right. And we knew that would be a moment because we'd always designed this game to be watchable, to be shareable. But I don't think we realized, you know, we hoped, but that moment when we lifted the NDA and everybody kind of came in and just kind of got to share their stories for the first time was amazing. And that just really kind of gave us that lift off towards launch, where we had so many people coming in to play that we, you know, we struggled to cope with the amount of people that were coming in. We had some challenges from a scale perspective because we just hadn't been able to test our systems at that scale. But, and, you know, it was fair to say there was some feedback at launch, right, in terms of from our audience, right? Like we had a core committed people that love Sea of Thieves. So a lot of people came in, and for some people were asking for different things and different stuff. You know, the kind of general sentiment, I think, at the broadest level was like, hey, this is really cool and really unique and really fun, but, you know, we want to see some of the bits of this fleshed out. We want to see some kind of just some more things, whether it's more trading companies or it's additional stuff that people wanted. And we always knew we had a long-term plan, a long-term vision to support this and to keep growing and that we wanted to listen to feedback. And so it was kind of a little bit of the, let's rip the band-aid off, let's hear it, and then let's go and kind of prioritize what our plans are based on what people want. And it's the energy and the enthusiasm that which the team ran at that, like in that kind of first year, especially the, you know, the first big update we did with the Megalodon, with the Hungering Deep, was a great foot forward for us. Like with the feedback we got, the stories we saw of people meeting and taking down this giant creature was amazing. And it's just kind of been upwards from there, really.
I'm sorry, I was waiting because I have my console here. And I've loaded it. Yeah. I've got the Lunar New Year skin, which was available for a while there. And I'm very proud. And I was it's funny because I was waiting for the sun to come up because, as you can see, it's coming up here. But what's interesting is I want to I'm actually very proud of this, if I may. I'm going to show you.
Yeah.
I do have the skin.
Nice.
So this is the one you've got to do. You've got to do a couple of the tall tales. You got to do one of the tall tales, I believe, three times. And there's a whole series of things.
Yeah, the Heart of Fire.
The Heart of Fire. So I was I'm very proud of that skin. I just wanted to flex a little bit there with you, Joe, and to show you that I really do play this game a lot.
Amazing. Yeah. You know, I've got the same skin. I went for that one. It felt like the right balance of, you know, I can do that tale three times. I can do the different kind of tunnels and stuff. Yeah.
Yeah. Check it out. I mean, that's a great skin to have. But it's, you know, when you're looking at all the features, and I'm guilty of this. I mean, I've sent you, hey, Joe, it would be great if you did this. Yes, and this. So I said, I have no compunction about sending you, no problem sending you emails. But when you look forward, you know, what are some of the areas that you're going to be focusing on? Because this is such a rich area. area. And I have even commented to some folks. I have a lot of friends who work at a large entertainment corporation that, if you would know it, they probably have a mouse as their mascot. And I'm saying, if you had that, the IP from like Pirates of the Caribbean, I don't think you guys could do it better. I think you're doing it so much better than anything like that. And I'm so thrilled with what you've done. And I just want to tell you that. But also, let's talk a little bit about where you're going to go with the game and what you see the future looking like.
Well, it's an interesting one. So we've obviously recently launched Seasons as kind of a new way of up both a new kind of rhythm for how we plan to release and update Sea of Thieves. So every few months we'll have a new season with a new set of rewards that you kind of go after. It's great. Look, level 31 already. Amazing. And it ends in 8 weeks. So, that's great, right? And actually, we've kind of balanced it to try and, you know, make it achievable for our kind of like our broadest audience. So it's going to be about 50 hours or so to kind of go through over a course of a season. We wanted to make sure it wasn't that you had to commit all of your time to Sea of Thieves if you wanted to do it. Like, you can find some more time for gaming, but also it was a bit of a challenge for Ungate. But so we've started entering into that rhythm. And so we're kind of in that, like, I know what's coming for the next few seasons. I know what our kind of headline stuff is. I can't talk about it, but we recently were going through the strategic planning actually for kind of season four. So if we think kind of September timeframe, late this year, and the process for that is we kind of meet with the leadership of the team who are going to be working on it, plus a few other people across the studio that bring some sort of strategic insights and thought to it. And so we have a set of almost strategic pillars for how we want to go update the game. What are the areas and opportunities? So not specifically, this is the things we'll do. It's more, these are the areas of opportunity that we're interested in. How can we go and do things that, I don't know, like give groups of players things to work towards and have goals and rewards around, as opposed to the kind of the progression at the moment is quite singular and it's about me, not necessarily about the crew. So there's an opportunity there. So how would we go fill that? And so, you know, we've gone through that process with our team, and the best bit about it is that people all bring their one pages to that, so they know what the strategic areas of opportunity are. And then they'll bring a single page with a few images on, and how does this meet this goal, and what's exciting about it? And everybody gets to bring their best ideas about how we can go and do something really cool that has some real value to our players, right? And the hardest bit is that for that single kind of what's going to be the single key thing we're going to go after is almost a headline thing for season four. There's like 15 of them to begin with. And then you have to go through and everybody talks through the ones they're passionate about. And then you do a bit of a filtering process, a bit of a voting process. You get it to three. And then you're like, okay, how do we go scope and figure this out? And so, but coming out of that process, I remember Simon, who kind of is our brand and kind of audience director at the studio, just messaged me and he was like, there's so many ideas, even just from that one session. He's like, should we just grow the team even more? Like, cause we could just do so much. And I just love that even though we're 3 years in, there's so much scope for where we could go with this. And I'm sure you've got a bunch of ideas and thoughts about things you would love to see added. But so almost everything that anybody suggests goes into one of two buckets, which is one is, that makes sense for Sea of Thieves. I'm sure at some stage we're going to get to that. And then the other one is like, maybe that's not the quite right thing. We don't want to head in that direction. But
I think that's where you put so all my ideas into that bucket.
Yeah, yeah. it's just later on the roadmap. But but that's the thing. It's like there's so many places we could take this. And, you know, our core community have loads of feedback about things they want to see improved or things they want to see added. We also have some stuff that we're super passionate about that maybe people haven't been suggesting and thought of. There's... the process of just figuring that out and planning what to do is actually fun and difficult because there's so many ways we could go. But it's about, you know, we've launched Seasons. Now we're getting into that rhythm of how we go and update and support it and transitioning how our team works around it. But the launch of Seasons has been really good. Like, players have really loved it. It's been a really kind of good engaging thing for people. Like, you're at level 31 already. So obviously you're playing and enjoying, and so now it's like, okay, cool. We're into this new rhythm, but we're seeing really good data and in terms of players engaging with it and playing and stuff. And like January was our biggest year ever, biggest month. In terms of monthly active users, which is a great way to kick off kind of this almost fourth year, right? It's amazing.
You talk about that. And the one thing I love about the new seasons is, and let me bring my character back up over here, bring my game up, is in the seasons you've got, and I don't know where it is in here, but you know, you've got the ability to, and I don't actually even see it in here, but as you're playing the game, it's like, okay, another nautical mile. Okay, you visited a new island. It's not just going on these various quests. It's for investigating the world. So, you know, just merely traveling from point A to point B, you're going to add some things that to your, you know, to your XP, right?
Yeah. And the thing, when we were looking at seasons, obviously there's different ways you can approach this. Different games have different kind of ways of doing this, but it's a nice rhythm of engagement. It's a nice period of time, but we wanted this to be something that just, we know that everybody plays Sea of Thieves differently, right? Yeah. Some people will go and do Tall Tales. Some will stick the Reaper's flag up and go and sink everyone they see. Some will go and do the kind of trading company quests. And it was like, you know what? Let's reward everybody for however they choose to play. So we're not forcing you to play in a certain way if you want to engage with seasons. It's just like, it's an additive thing on top of how people play already. And there are ways to dig in deeper if you want with the trials, where you can go and earn renown if you go and take on these things and if you want to whiz your way through seasons. But if you just want to play Sea of Thieves, then you're just going to be rewarded. And not only that, the it's about rewards in a session, whereas at the previously Sea of Thieves is all about the rewards at the end, right? Where, and there's risk in that, right? Which is, you go out, you've got the treasure, you fill it on the boat, and then but there's a risk that could be lost, and you could spend hours playing and then kind of have a frustrating end to a session. And so hopefully seasons can soften that blow, because that will still happen. There's still risk, but you know, you will get rewarded as you go, and filling in kind of the gaps of a new adventure of just exploring or doing quests, like you're making progress. We really like that balance, and a lot of careful thought went into that from our design team about, let's not change how people play, like let's allow them to play how they want, give them ways to dig in deeper if they want to, but otherwise they just want to play and get rewarded. That's cool too.
Well, that's what's, and it's interesting you say about people playing it the way they want to. You're absolutely right. I've played with people that want to just go find every ship and sink them, or you know, just go deliver or go fetch chickens in crates. I mean, there's a ton of things to do. The other thing that I've noticed is, I'm sure you've heard this, is I've actually, a lot of my team meetings, they want to do them in Sea of Thieves, you know, because we're talking while we're doing things, and there's, you know, there's team building because we all have to get the boat and do something. But that's too, I could talk to you for another half hour, but I need to let you go. You know, but I do need to get my feature request in, Joe. I think this is a new one.
Okay. Let's hear it.
I really want at the end of my session for you to give me a tally. This is what you did. This is how much gold you put in the bank. These are how many miles, you know, just kind of, even if I can just go to the website and show me, hey, you played for 45 minutes two nights ago. This is what you did.
That's an interesting one, because that is relatively, that is not a necessarily common one. Yeah, I'm just trying to think about it. And but okay, I'll.
Because that's the one thing, because I remember, because one of the famous, you know, we have a good friend, you and I, who plays a lot, Ryan Trite. And he plays a lot, and he's on to me now. But famously, he would go out and do a bunch of quests. I'm like, I can't, you know, I'm texting him, I can't join. And then I would join for the last half hour and just take in all the gold. I'm like, how much did I get? I don't know. He doesn't do that. He doesn't let me join anymore. But I just would love to see at the end of those evenings, how, you know, or the end of this session, how we did as a team, right? How many times were we in the wind or not in the wind or whatever, you know, how many times do we have a megalodon attack or how many times, whatever. So that's it. I'll let you, I see you thinking about that.
Yeah. Like, that's the thing. I'm like, we definitely have the stats. So, you know, like we track all of that stuff. So, it is not beyond the realms of possibility to do that.
This is not official confirmation of a new feature coming. I'm very, very clear. This is my behalf. So
it's definitely in the list of, that makes sense. That's something we could do. It's in that bucket. It's not in the other one. So we're good.
Ooh, I made one. Anyway, Joe, I want to just congratulate you and Mike and the entire team there for such great work. And the most important thing that I can tell you, the listeners and viewers, is just go check it out. It's part of Game Pass. You know, you've already got the game. Download it. It's a fun, and you know, even if you don't have somebody, you know, just go out by yourself. You can do a solo journey, right? There's a way to do that. And I know you've got some onboarding process for that, right, Joe?
Yes, the maiden voyage was something we introduced maybe more than a year ago now, but a much better onboarding kind of flow for players. And yeah, like, come join in, or join in the community, join the Discord, come to the forums, or, you know, come on Twitter. There's an amazing Sea of Thieves community and that welcome new players, right? So if you come out and you're just posting and looking, there will be people who like to, you know, super experienced players that love to take, like Ryan, like Ryan Tright, like he loves to take new people on journeys and introduce them to the game. The same exists throughout our community. So come out, get involved if you're not sure, and there will be people that will kind of be happy to take you under their wing and get you on that journey to Pirate Legend.
And show you exactly what you need to do. And there's, I guarantee, to play the game, there's something in the game for everybody. Even if you just want to sail out to the middle of the ocean and drop anchor and watch the sunrise and the sunset, there's something to do.
Yep, exactly. It's yeah, it's a magical game, and it's just going to keep getting more and more things and more kind of adventures. So,
all right,
yeah, Joe, jump on in.
I'll let you go again. Congratulations on the almost 3 years of success. I look forward to seeing what you guys are going to be doing in the years ahead. My best to everybody at the team, and we'll see you on the high seas. Thanks, Joe.
Yeah, see you on the seas.
Thanks to Joe, Three Sheets, Neate, that's his pirate name. And yeah, the game, it's just funny talk. Every time you bring up that we played like that, like super early version of the game, and you knew there was magic there.
Yeah.
And it's just amazing how the game continues to evolve. Sort of got like a Friday night thing going on now of these long voyages. And I do really love how they implemented the battle pass.
What was your pirate name?
It was Rum Rubenstein. It was a Rum Rubenstein. Yeah.
I think mine was Admiral Nelson.
Yours kind of writes itself. Just had to just translate major to the Navy. Yeah, it's been like a really good time. And it's just awesome to see how many people have played that game over the past, 3 years now.
Yeah.
So time flies, Larry.
Same with Apex with a couple of years. So it was a good, lots of great gaming. So thank you for that. We got Jason on. We squeezed Jason in because he, you know, contractually he wants to be on the show.
Yep. Well, it's, you know, at some point I'm going to be like, what time are we doing the show, Larry? And you're going to be like, why don't you just sit this week out? Yeah, just week out. Go get
Friday,
lunch early.
Friday,
you know,
you'll be
don't worry about it.
Twitter, and here's the show.
So, yeah.
No, I won't do that to you.
Well, you know what? The fans, we're doing it for them. And if they want more JR, they'll get the JR that they want.
They want features, is what they want. So
yes, exactly.
That's all they want. They want features.
I could make the argument that I'm useless outside of this capacity, whereas as Jason Ronald, actually, let's get him back behind the computer.
Yeah, it's not true. You're not useless as far as you know.
I don't know. We'll figure it out. I'm not fishing for a compliment here. A couple other real quick things before we go. I wanted to call out that speaking of games that continue to evolve, Microsoft Flight Simulator had its third world update. We've had Japan, I believe we had the US, and now UK and Ireland. Which is, it's by the time you read this, it's updated, enhanced visuals, handcrafted scenery, custom airports, great new soundtrack from Haven, and exciting new activities. So it's really cool to see that keeps going, specifically the calling out locations like Birmingham, Bristol, London, Oxford, Cambridge, and some of the airports like Liverpool.
Because they're out there in the Midlands.
They're out there in like Sheepy Magna or something, yeah. Which sounds like something I'm making up, but I swear I'm not. There were a lot of sheep when I went out there. It's beautiful, beautiful country. No Man's Sky, another one.
Yes.
Just keeping pace. They've now added companions. So it's essentially, you know, they added six big updates last year, and this is their first big update this year. And basically, like, you can get a pet, and it's not just like a pet like that rides on your shoulder, but like megafauna, like something that you can ride and you can raise, it can lay eggs, and there's just more stuff to do. And that game is going on like 5 years now. It's kind of crazy. So great work, Hello Games, keeping that updated. And
that
one
game,
last thing.
I just need to say it
go
about
on.
That game
no, no,
once go. Again. You need to check it out. It's the game that gives for me, one of the purest experiences of leaving the atmosphere and going into space as you fly your spacecraft up. It feels so like I think it would be. Obviously, I've never done it, but I just remember flying that. I remember.
Haven't you?
apparently in my
dreams. You wouldn't tell me if you did.
But I forgot about it. But yeah, just getting in your ship and prepping and taking off and leaving the, you know, going over the atmosphere and into the stratosphere. It just feels so like you think it would be. It's pretty cool.
Yeah. I need to go back to it. I have it downloaded all the time. What I need to do is just strap back in. And I've completely lost myself when it first came out in the game. I think I played it on PC for, I mean, it was just constantly playing it. It's almost hypnotic at times.
Yeah, it's like Sea of Thieves in that when it launched, versus now, it's just a very different game. So it's worth checking out. So I applaud the teams that have been working on that.
Absolutely. All right. Yeah, that, my friend, what
a show. I mean, I never know. Every week we go on a show, we never know. We're going to have guests.
We don't even know how many, even if you've done the interview, you might not remember how many guests you have on the show.
You're darn right. We get everybody wants to be on the show. We got even more interviews lined up for the coming week. I know you're going to be doing a couple. We can't talk about them yet.
Yeah.
We're going to have people on the show that have never been on the show before. Let's just say that.
That's good. We should keep that up.
Let's keep that up. So we're going to keep going through things. Anything you want to add before we wrap up here, Jeffrey?
But just say as the week goes on, next week will be our second week. It's the final week of February, and we will have five takeovers on the Xbox Twitch channel. So tune in. It's usually around noon-ish Pacific, but we'll be tweeting it out, and you can take a look. Actually, I've been fleeting about. So if you follow Xbox on Twitter, look at the fleets.
Are you doing
fleets? Let you know who's coming up.
Are you doing fleets?
I consume fleets, but I haven't made any. I make Instagram stories. I just haven't fleeted. Should I fleet?
I try to do that. For those of you who don't know, fleets are like Instagram stories, but they're on Twitter, thus the name fleets.
Yeah. I don't know why I don't just syndicate them, but I just haven't done it. Maybe I'll start.
All right. Well, yeah, but anyway, you've got the real, by the way, congratulations. You've done a great job lining amazing talent up to join us on the Xbox channel this month. So thank you for all of that, Jeff. I know you and your team.
Oh, well, I mean, we're happy to introduce you, the viewer, to new voices in the Xbox community. And there's some really great folks. So if you like who you see, make sure you follow them on their channel and keep the goodness going.
And of course, if you like what you see here, what do you do, Jeff?
Please. Like, subscribe, ring the ding-a-ling bell, so you know when a new episode's there. And thanks always for commenting. We've been having fun jumping into the comments once the show goes live on YouTube. Thank you so much, we appreciate your thumbs ups. Let us know what you think.
Somebody was talking. We were talking. I saw that in the comments and about a show open, like a more video graphical show open. So you know what we should do. You know, I was just thinking maybe I'll reach out to the team from Haven and we'll make something similar with you and I.
If the Game Bakers are listening, how could you imagine if they redid that, but it was the two of us, you know, and
nightmare
coffee
fuel.
Flying nightmare through fuel. And Toto toilet seats.
So we're just, you guys, everybody here is along for the journey with us, along with the show.
Yes.
So
thank you. I hope you play the game. I hope you enjoy it. There's just so much goodness there.
Well, we'll work on, we got a bunch of interviews coming up in the future. We're going to get an engineer to talk about the new headset, which is available for pre-order now. You can see the box right there, and it's shipping very soon. So this is a great
mid-March.
Headset. Jeff and I, just to let you know, we've been testing this for quite some time. So we've used it.
This was another Easter egg. I think a lot of you saw that, but in our commercial in, I want to say in November, I think October, it was Daniel Kaluuya was wearing this headset in the video. It was hiding in plain sight. It was there all along.
We got to stop doing that because we're going to get in trouble.
Well, people are going to start looking into you like, I think I see something, but you know what?
That by the way, that Eagle down there is a Xbox adaptive controller. People are probably wondering what that is under my, I don't know what else.
Yeah, I'm hiding a lamp and an old Vive. I got to put something else there, but it is what it is.
The lamp looks a little tilty.
I got to put it, we're still working on this room. I got to tilt my camera. There's a soccer jersey and a controller. Here we go. That's the coolest. Look at the blanket.
Are those plaques you've got there? Those.
Oh, that was a gift from, I know I'm off-centered here, from your average consumer who's an Eagles fan. And when the Eagles won the Super Bowl, he surprised me with there's a little piece of like a game ball in there. One of the nicest guys in on YouTube. You're talking about the thing hanging on the wall, right?
No, I'm talking about those two green things.
Oh, that. Okay. So that is something you might have seen some creators have this in Australia, our Australian team. They make some really cool stuff. And it is a light box. It's basically two neon lights that it kind of is supposed to represent the Xbox Series X.
Right.
So over Christmas, they had one left. And we had like a big white elephant, you know, like a gift exchange right before Christmas. And I managed to snag that. And I actually just arrived at the house last week. So some point I'll have it plugged in. I need to figure out the wiring because it has to plug in. But I really like that thing.
Fine addition. Yeah, I've got so much stuff that I could share. You don't want to see this. It's
yeah, that's it's, all. That's it. That's the entirety of the stuff I have.
That's
you
the show.
You've got a whole thing. That's we should do, you know, a common sort of YouTube video is like, you know, this is my setup. And I think a lot of people would be interested in your setup, Larry.
So this setup is one thing, but I'm just talking about the stuff that I have.
That's my point. Your setup can be the things in the background. It could be a series. You got a channel. Use it.
I know. I do have a channel, and I just, you know, I got a daytime job. I don't have time to sit here, roll some YouTube picture. I would love to, but maybe in the future. Thank you for that idea.
You've got the time.
Thank you for that time. All right, gang. We're going to see you next week with a bunch of with more interviews, some surprise interviews. I think. I don't know. Maybe Jeff will be doing some. Maybe not. We'll hopefully have.
We'll figure it out.
You'll be back.
Or Jason Ronald will do it for us.
Jason says he's not available. So can you join me next week?
Okay. Wow. The sad thing is that may be true. So
terrible move. All right, gang. Any final words before we go, Jeff?
It's always a pleasure here, Larry. It's a
pleasure to see
you. It's always a pleasure.
Everybody else, like, subscribe. Hit us up on, if you want to hit us up on Twitter, it's very simple. You just follow right down there at Jeff Rubenstein. There you go. At Major Nelson. We'll see you guys next week with some more news, some more interviews, and a lot more fun. Thanks, everybody. Bye-bye.